Hindi pa. Welcome pa lang ako. Mag-welcome pa lang ako. Okay, sige.
Ay, ikaw muna.
Apo. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to church and welcome to the 21st night of our evangelism. I would like to welcome those of you who came here at the church and those of you who are watching us through online through Facebook, YouTube. Thank you so much for joining us today. Happy Sabbath. For tonight's program, I would like to give you the names of the participants. The opening prayer will be given to us by Pastor Teody Malabanan. Our praise team will be Ate Mirna Keith and Pastor Teody Malabanan. Our special music is from Kuya Oscar Pilonio from Burnaby Vilcan Church. I pray that we will all be blessed by the message that we will be hearing tonight. Happy Sabbath. Pastor Teody, Sister Mirna. Let's sing hymn number 383, O Day of Rest and Gladness. Let's all stand up and sing our theme song when we all get to heaven. Thank you.
Okay, shall we all bow down our heads for our prayer? Most gracious God, and yet our Heavenly Father, this evening, Lord, we would like to praise you, give you the praises for your goodness to all of us, and we would like to worship you at this Sabbath day. Thank you so much, Lord, for the week that you showered us with blessings, not only material but spiritual blessings. Thank you for your protections, for your love, and everything that we have experienced throughout the week. And as we worship you this Sabbath day, O Lord, be with us and accept us just as we are, forgiven by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you for the assurance that you will be with us and bless those people who are watching online through Facebook and YouTube, and especially your servant tonight, Pastor Leomar Makaraig, as he will deliver your message to all of us. May we all be blessed and enlightened with the truth from you. And thank you so much, Lord, for all things you have given to us and for answering our prayers, for your presence to us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The title is He's Been Faithful to Me. In my moment of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, He's been faithful to me. Every word His promise is true. What I thought was impossible, I see my God do. He's been faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet He's been faithful, faithful to me. When my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, still my God, He was faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly, reaching out for what pleased me, even then, God was faithful to me. Every time I come back to Him, He is waiting with open arms, and I see once again. He's been faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet He's been faithful, faithful, faithful. Oh, in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet He's been faithful, faithful. In my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yes, He's been faithful, faithful to me. Yes, He's been faithful to me.
Thank you, Brother Oscar. He has been faithful to me. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good evening to all of you. Welcome to our church. Yes. This is the 21st night of our presentation. And praise the Lord for giving us and sustaining us energy. Each one of us to continue to attend Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday evening. And tonight is about the confirmation and vindication. And this is very crucial for us because as a church, we believe that the product of our faith and salvation is none other than obedience. And sometimes people fail to understand these teachings of the Bible because they were only focused on what Christ did on the cross, and that's it, as if Jesus Christ is doing nothing after that. So let us take a look at some of the presentations of the Bible. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. So this righteousness and justice, they go hand in hand. It is not only righteousness, but there's also justice with God. And that is why you would always see this concept or teaching in the books of the five books of Moses, especially parts of the commandments of God. When Moses asked God, "Show me your glory," you will see there that even in the Ten Commandments, God also visits the iniquity of children up to how many generations? Fourth generations. That's part of His justice, but at the same time, He is righteous. And the Lord passed before Him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin by no means, clearing the guilty and visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. Now you would see the context here. This is Exodus 34. And the people of God decided to have a covenant with God, right? And you will see that in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning with verse 5 and then 6 and 7, you will see there that the one of the roles of parents is to teach the law of God to their children. And that is why this is until the fourth generation, mix of righteousness and justice of God, at the same time, love and truth. Then in Genesis 22, it says there, the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your son, your only son, blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. In your seed of all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. Now this is, as I mentioned, this is very crucial, because for some people, obedience is not important when it comes to relationship with God. There were two experiences of Abraham. One, when God made a promise to him that he will have a son. He was about 100 years old, but God made a promise. And in fact, he said to Sarah, next year I will visit you, and at the time you will have a son. It means that whatever God says, that will come true, because God cannot tell a lie. And because of that, Abraham believed God. And according to the explanation of Paul, and also in the book of Genesis, it was counted to him as what? Righteousness. The context is when he believed God, because according to the story, because of the deadness of Sarah's womb, and he is also 100 years old. So it is impossible for a human to have a son in that age. But God made a promise, and he believed that promise. And according to the Bible, it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, when Paul used that statement in the book of Romans, the context is almost the same. Abraham and Sarah cannot do it, but God made a promise. And now in chapter 4 of Romans, this is the explanation of Paul. What shall we say then? That Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, has found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he has whereof to glory, but not before God. For what says the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Not to him that works is the reward, not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that works not, but believes on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. So Paul used this story of Abraham when it comes to what? Forgiveness of sin. I mentioned a good example of this one. I hope you still remember that story or that example. If you were wanted in Vancouver because you raped 150 women, and the Vancouver council said that this guy is wanted, and anyone who can, let's say, tell his residence or location that guy will receive how many million dollars? Did I say 15 million? 50? And you're wanted dead or alive. So even though you repented of your sin, you cry with blood, and you say to yourself, I forgive my sin. But if the verdict is you're still wanted, when you come out of your secret place, you're still wanted. But if Vancouver says, well, let's say we need to forgive this man because it is almost New Year, and we need this man to be with his family, so he is not wanted anymore, he is free to roam around. And yet you are still hiding under the sewage system of Vancouver. No, I will not come out because that is only propaganda. It is the same thing. We cannot work out for our sin in order for God to forgive us. It is by the declaration of God. Another example, verse 6, is David. That's why this is the famous quotation in Psalm 32, beginning from verse 1, saying in verse 7 of Romans 6, blessed are whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. It is about the context is forgiveness of sin. And then Paul continued to Abraham, beginning again from verse 10 up to the last verse 25. Now, Paul used this statement again when he received, or when God made a promise, according to chapter 4, verse 17, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickens the dead and calls those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall your seed be. Verse 21. Or 20. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. You see the explanation of Paul. Because God made a promise and he was able to perform it, he believed, okay? And according to the Bible, who against hope believe in hope. Because God can call the things which do not exist as if they were exist or existed. Can you imagine 1 year, or yes, 1 year before that time, God said, you will have a son next year. But it will take 9 months again for Sarah to form that baby in her womb. But prior to that, 1 year before, God said, you will have a son, I will visit you next year. And Abraham believed that, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, our reading now in chapter 22 of Genesis, the context is different. The context, and when he received Isaac as the promised son, and the angel said to him, let me go back a little bit. Then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your son, your only son, blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gates of their enemies. In your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. Now when you look at Galatians, that in your seed is in singular, that points to Jesus Christ. Okay? Jesus Christ is the seed of the woman. Now the context here is by obedience. And this, according to James, is what we called the confirmation of faith. All right, Abraham received the promise, his son Isaac, but God told him to offer his only son Isaac on Mount Moriah, and he obeyed. That's why the wording here is in verb tense, obeyed, and you have done. Okay? Because of that, in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. And now let's take a look at the explanation of James. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was that Abraham, our father, justified by what? By works, when he offered Isaac, his son, on the altar. And some people will argue why people argue in this one? Because in Romans chapter 3, no flesh is justified by the deeds of the law. Because the context is different. It is about a sinner who wants to have a forgiveness for his sin. And forgiveness of sin is not by works of the law or by works of man. It is the gift of God. It is based on the declaration of God, if you believe that God is a forgiving God. Now, the context now in James and in Genesis 22 is different. So that's why James said, well, faith without works is dead. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered Isaac, his son, on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works? And by works, faith was made perfect. Well, some people say mature or perfect. You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. And this is the confirmation of faith. What confirmed my faith is my works, the product of faith. Just like what happened to Abraham, that's why the readings there is very important, because the angel said, by myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing, and will not withheld your son, your only son, blessing, I will bless you. And let me go back a little bit to that passage. I would like to see Genesis 22, because I think I forgot to mention one thing here. Genesis 22, that verse is 15. You can check your Bible there. Oh, because I'm using other translation here. It's all right. All right, I will multiply your seed. And the last verse, in your seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. Anyway, let's go to James. So faith without works is dead faith, as like to a body without spirit or breath of life is dead. So this is very important, because this is confirmation of faith, right? Now, in Romans 1, did I skip something? Through him, we have received grace and apostleship for the obedience of faith, according to modern English version. Among all the nations for his name, among whom you also are called by Jesus Christ. So let me go back a little bit there, because in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. And according to Galatians, the seed is none other than Jesus Christ. And that's why I shared with you last night, I think, that in the book of Romans chapter 5, the basis is not on our works, but the basis is on the obedience of the one man, Jesus Christ, because he is the seed. Because of the obedience of Jesus Christ, many shall be made righteous. He is the seed of the woman, and that is the oath of God in the book of Genesis. Because of the obedience of the Son, shall many be made righteous. And I share with you the reason why I share with you about sons in the wilderness, the firstborn son, the adopted son, because those topics has connection with the title of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, or the firstborn son. It is very crucial. That's why sometimes you will read the book of Hebrews chapter 1, he is also an heir of all things. Through him, we can be also an heir of all things, because he is the second Adam. Now, here is what the obedience of faith. Let's go to Romans chapter 6. Do not yield your members to sin as instruments of righteousness. This is what chapter? Chapter 6 of Romans. When you read chapter 6 of Romans, Paul talks about baptism. Right? After baptism, Paul encouraged the Romans to yield themselves to God. And then he said in verse 13, do not yield your members to sin as instruments of righteousness, but yield yourselves to God as those who are alive from the dead, and your bodies to God as instruments of righteousness. Do you not know that to whom you yield yourselves as slaves to obey, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. Now, if you are a very keen individual, why Paul said this? Because once again, many people fail to understand, and I read it to you last night, that the topic in Romans chapter 3 has something to do with our past sins. Romans chapter 3, verse 25, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remissions of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. Our past sins. But God declared his righteousness by faith, and we believe that God is a forgiving God. It we believe that God will forgive us. That's why chapter 4, verse 7, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whom the Lord will not impute sin. The context is about forgiveness of sin, past sins. Now, after you baptize, Romans chapter 6, Paul says, well, yield yourselves to righteousness to God. Because if you will obey sin again, you will be slaves of sin. But if you obey righteousness, you are slaves of righteousness. The result is obedience. Right? Because God is not dealing with your past sins anymore. And that is why the righteous judgment of God is based on works. Because many people claim that they are in Christ, but by their works they deny him. So, this is the key words there. You are slaves of the one whom you obey, or of obedience leading to righteousness. Some Christians, they are anemic and allergy to the word obedience, because they believe what people say about us. And that's why the conclusion, Seventh-day Adventists always obey and follow because they are legalists. Where did they learn that? From other people, not from the Bible. But if they will only believe the Bible, they will have a different understanding of the message of God. Now, 17, But thanks be to God, for you were slaves of sin. You were slaves of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of teaching to which you were trusted. And having been freed from sin, you became the slaves of righteousness. The key word there is number one, having been freed from sin. Sin has no dominion over you. Chapter 6 and the verses 7. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, verse 8. If we dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died to sin once. But in that he lives to God. Likewise, at the same thing, count, in other translation, in my Bible, reckon you also yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So we are no longer slaves of sin. We have been freed from sin and became the slaves of righteousness because we yield this body, as obedient slaves of righteousness. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you have yielded your members as slaves to impurity and iniquity, leading to more iniquity, even so now, yield your members as slaves to righteousness unto holiness. Now, I like that word because in New American Standard Bible, the word holiness, there is sanctification. It is the same thing. Holiness or sanctification is the same thing. So our obedience is the confirmation of faith that we receive to God. Our obedience is the confirmation of our faith. Without obedience, faith is dead. Now you talk to other religious organizations or groups of people, and they will tell you that they also obey. But when it comes to the law, they don't want to obey the law. I didn't know why, because according to the Bible, they are still in the flesh. Those in the flesh cannot be subject to the law of God. According to Romans 8, what verse is that? Verse 7. We need to master Romans, I think, the book of Romans, because this is the complete systematic theology of Paul. The book of Romans. All right, so we are now members of righteousness to holiness or sanctification. But now, having been freed from sin and having become slaves of God, you have fruit unto holiness, and the end is eternal life. Now in Romans 13, Paul mentioned about the commandments of God, okay? And he summarized the commandments of God, just like what Jesus Christ said in Matthew 19 and Matthew 22. And he said there, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. After enumerating the second part of the Ten Commandments, his summary is the same with Jesus Christ. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Okay? Now, and then 13, 10 to 11, love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. In my Bible that I use, it says there, 13, is love is the fulfilling of the law. And do this. Why we need to do that? Because we know that the coming of our Lord is nearer than when we first believe. Well, if you ask some people, say we don't need to do that because we are already saved. I think Paul is not in line with your thinking, because Paul says, do this, knowing the time that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Do this. What are those? This, love, does no harm to a neighbor. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And you go back to verse 8, you will see this part of the commandments of God. Now, Romans 15. Again, the purpose is to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. Okay? 19, your obedience has become known to all men. Therefore, I am glad on your behalf, yet I want you to be wise to that which is good and innocent to that which is evil. Now, which is good? In the broader context of Romans, yet I want you to be wise to that which is good. Romans 7, what is good? In Romans, verse 12, wherefore the law is holy, the commandment holy, just and good. You know, when I give Bible study with some people who are members of other denominations, and they are sometimes combative, okay? They want to argue. They say that we don't need to obey the law. Like transgressing the Sabbath law is not sin. I said, "Thou, who told you? Who said that?" I said, "You can read the book of Nehemiah, and you can read the book of Jeremiah. It is there." And they responded, "Ah, that's in the Old Testament. We are talking New Testament." "Ah, okay. You are talking about New. Okay, let's read." I said, "Turn your Bible to James." And I read this part in James chapter 4, verse 17. Therefore, to him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin. Is it clear? What is that good that we need to do? Romans 7, 12. Therefore, the law is holy, the commandment holy, just and good. If you fail that, you're committing sin. Right? Now, let's go back to James, I said. Why James decided to say that? Because in James, when you read chapter 2, verse 8, if you fulfill the royal law, according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you have respect to persons and commit sin and are convicted of the law as transgressors, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offended in one point, he is guilty of all. For he that said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not kill. Now, if you commit no adultery, yet if you kill, you are become transgressor of the law. According to Paul, the law is good, and if you fail to do it, it is sin. So, what do you think, brother? You just let the Bible explain itself, because the more you say based on just understanding, on the back of these people, you're just saying what you know, but that based on the Bible. If the Bible speaks, then they don't have any argument with that one. So, your obedience has become known to all men. Now, to him who has power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret for long ages past, but now is revealed by the prophetic scriptures, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all the Gentiles for the obedience of faith. And that is why we obey. That is the product of the faith that we receive. It is free, but that faith has product. Faith without works is dead. Now, is this Galatians? Okay, Galatians. According to Galatians, again, this is the faith which works by love. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? Oh, we study about the truth. So let me clarify this one. This is faith which works by love. Okay? So our obedience is by love. Faith which works by love. Loving obedience is not legalism. And he asked the Galatians, you did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? What are the truth? Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. What else? Sanctify them through your truth. Your word is truth. The entirety of your word is truth. And every one of your righteousness judgment endures forever. And again, your righteousness and everlasting righteousness and your law is the truth. You are near, O Lord, and all your commandments are truth. These are the focus of the enemies. These three. Satan. Yes, Satan is the enemy. But the focus is number one, Jesus Christ. Second is the Word of God. The third is the law or the commandments of God, because those are the truth. And who hinder you from obeying the truth? Who? It is not God. Some people say that. Romans 2. But because of your hardness and impenitent heart, you are storing up treasures of wrath against yourselves on the day of wrath, when the righteous judgment of God will be revealed, and he will render to every man according to what? To his deeds. Because the context, is judgment of God. To those who by patiently doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality will be eternal life. But to those who are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, there are always two groups of people. One who obeys the truth, the other one obeys righteousness. They also obey, but they obey unrighteousness. They obey their leaders. But there's another group who obeys the Word of God, because they base their belief and faith on God's Word. So they still obey. But when it comes to the law and commandments of God, particularly the Sabbath and the law of the animals that may be eaten and the animals that may not be eaten, they say, no, we don't obey that. And you will tell this kind of people, you know them. Anyway, it is by works and obedience will be tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man who does evil, to the Jew first and also to the Gentiles. But glory and honor and peace will be to every man who does good work, to the Jew first and then to the Gentiles. For there is no partiality with God. For the hearers of the law are not justified before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. This kind of justification is what I called vindication of faith. The other one is confirmation of faith. James is about confirmation of faith. This one is vindication of faith. When, in the day, when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of men through Jesus Christ. I encountered one guy who read Romans chapter 3, and he said, verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. And I said, amen, brother, amen. We believe 100%. So what is your question? Because the Bible says, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified. We don't need to obey the law. I said, your conclusion is wrong. What you have read is right, but your conclusion is wrong. Okay, let me ask Paul. Paul, what will happen to those who obey the law? There, the doers of the law will be justified. Now I said, how can you harmonize that? This is only one chapter. This is chapter 2, 13. What you read is 3, verse 20. Now, how can you harmonize that? It is only one author, one book. How can you harmonize? Because they people, they also jump to, we don't need to obey the law. Who told you that? So when you encounter this kind of people, let them read from the Bible. But what's their conclusion? Because most of the time, conclusion is not connected to what they have read. Now, this is a classic example. Only one chapter, the doers of the law will be justified, because the context is about judgment. The context, again, Romans 3, Romans 4, Romans 5, the context is what? A sinner needs to be justified, needs to be forgiven. That is by declaration of God. That is the context. But if the context is judgment, this is about vindication of those people who obey the law. We will tell you later. We will read later as we go on. So this is about confirmation, and this one is vindication. There are three kinds. Romans 2, justification there is vindication. Romans 3 is about forgiveness of sin or declaration. In order for a sinner to be righteous, God declare him as a righteous because he believed in God that who can forgive sin. Right? But in James, the justification there is vindication of faith. Now, even Paul says, what is more important? Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing. But the keeping of the commandments of God is everything. Now, that's why when people says, oh, we don't need to keep the law. Who told you? Maybe your pastor told you that, but not my Bible. That's why we need to know our Bible, okay? Because sometimes we always agree. Yes, we agree with those people who read the Bible, but watch out for their conclusion. Because every time you compare the conclusion of those people, it is against the conclusion of Paul. It depends upon the context, right? Now here, what matters is the keeping of the commandments of God. That is everything. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. Oh, this is very crucial. I heard some people, and I watched because they were former Adventists. And they fought hard. And this guy asked these people, and they say, well, how about the keeping of the commandments of God? And one guy read this in 1 John chapter 5, verse 3. And he said, and I quote, this is what Seventh-day Adventists always read, 1 John 5, 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. And then you know what? And then he explained. He explained this. And he said, Seventh-day Adventists think that this keep His commandments is the Ten Commandments. And he said, it is not. It is actually in verse 21, chapter 4. And this commandment have we from Him, that he who loves God love his brothers also. I said, right, amen, brother. I keep watching the video. And I said, but the conclusion again is not right. Because he said, this is not the Ten Commandments. Now, we read in Romans 13, all right? Paul mentioned the other half of the commandment, right? And what is the conclusion? Love your neighbor as yourself. It points to the commandments. And when you read Matthew 22, let's have a short Bible study here. Matthew 22. Okay. Verse 36, Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like to it, you shall love your neighbors yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Very good. Praise the Lord for this. Okay? Now, further explanation of Jesus Christ, turn to Matthew 19, and it's almost the same thing. Matthew 19, 17, he said to him, why do you call me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if you will enter into life, keep the commandments. And he says to him, which? Jesus said, you shall not do murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. It is the same, based on the Ten Commandments. And how about God? Oh, 21. Jesus said to him, if you will be perfect, go and sell that you have and give to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Now, if you check this in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 6, the first commandment, verse 5, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That is the statement that Jesus Christ used. But the broader context is in chapter 5 of Deuteronomy, and it talks about the Ten Commandments. The other half explained, love your neighbors yourself. But love the Lord your God talks about the other half, because the context is the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy 5. Okay? This is in Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. So, when we go to 1 John, this guy said that this is not based on the Ten Commandments. I believe he is wrong again and again. Again and again, because he said, chapter 4, 21, and this is the commandment that we have from him, that he who loves God loves also his brother. It is the same thing. Love God and love your brother, love your neighbor. It is based on the Ten Commandments. And in the New Testament, even Jesus Christ and Paul, in order for us that our obedience is not based on legalism, obedience now is based on love. Because the Ten Commandments is actually love. Love your God, love your neighbor. And not only that, in chapter 3, verse 23, this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son Jesus Christ and love one another as he gave us commandment. And you can read this in John 14, John 15, if you love me, keep my commandment. It is the same commandment. Why they say this 1 John 4, 1 John 3 is not about the Ten Commandments? Why do you think? There you go. They want to set aside the Ten Commandments. That's it. You see? Now, even in the book of Revelation, blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. Can you imagine that? Almost last book of the New Testament. Chapter 22. Jesus Christ said, blessed are those who do his commandments. And that is why Revelation 12, 17, Revelation 14, 12, Satan is angry with those who keep the commandments of God. Because keeping the commandments of God is the one that confirm and vindicate our faith in him. That's why when you read John chapter 15, is it John chapter 15? Jesus Christ said, let me check my Bible. I am the vine, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, you are clean, though the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me, and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. That's why you take the word Christ in Christian, and you have only I-A-N. It means I am nothing. That's what we are. Okay? Verse 6, if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. That's why, this is the reason why 1 John says that those who keep the commandments of God, they are the one that abides in me. Let me read that part. 1 John 3, chapter 24. He that keeps his commandments dwells in him, and he in him, and hereby we know that he abides in us by the Spirit which he has given us. And also this is a demonstration of our love in chapter 5, verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. And that is why Revelation 22 says, we are blessed because we keep his commandments. That's the confirmation and vindication of our faith. Now, who has the source of salvation? The obedient or the disobedient? The obedient people. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. I think this is very clear. What will happen to those who do not obey? One thing is sure, according to the Bible. I heard this. I encountered this when I was in college doing home parish ministry. Okay, I was preaching in Santa Cruz, Laguna. Yeah, I was preaching there. I said I want informative preaching. While I was preaching, I asked question, and one guy, because my question is, I was very on fire during that time. He stick to the point. Okay. I mentioned this one, and he said, after the sermon, Pastor, are you God that knows people who will not be saved? I said, I am not God, but based on the word of God, this will happen to those who do not obey. Let me read to you. I read this part. Okay, I hope you read this part also. And what would happen to them? Here. It is a righteous matter with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They shall be punished with eternal destruction, isolated from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. And some people say, well, Pastor, it is very hard to obey. It is hard to obey if you keep on yourself. But there is a man who obeyed for you. If you trust him, number one, his righteousness and obedience will be imputed to your account. And he will give you grace so that your faith is an active faith. It's alive. It is not stagnant. And that faith will obey. And that's what we call the obedience of faith. But while you are in that group, you don't have power to obey, because the teaching is we don't need to obey because we are saved. But when you follow the Word of God, you will become an obedient person of God. Because I share with you that in the last days, during the time of visitation, so that they may see your good works and glorify God your Father which is in heaven. That is not for our glorification, that is for the glorification of our Father which is in heaven. That's why every time we share our testimony, just like what Brother Leon shared to us many times ago, look at his life before and his life now. It is a total change. That is the power of the gospel. And when he believed that and put his life into that, what is the result? He obeys. And now he realized, oh, I lost. What did you say? The most important thing in life. It's more happier now compared to my life before. That is the result. And that is why Satan hates those people who obey, because their works, their obedience will give a witness to the people that in the last days they will glorify God. And they cannot say, oh no, I cannot just do it right. That's why Jesus Christ said, abide in me and I will abide in you. You will bear much fruit if you abide in me. If you just leave yourself alone, I-A-N, no Christ, you are nothing. I am nothing. That's it. That's why this is very crucial. When he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be marveled at by all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed. Oh, when we all get to heaven. All right, let me explain a little more here. Because our covenant is 9, right? I'll take 5 more minutes on this one. Let's go back to the book of Romans, because this is very crucial. And I preach on this one in the book of Romans. How many groups in the book of Romans? You still remember? There are at least 3 groups or 4. When you read chapter 1, beginning from verse 18 up to 32, that is the first group. The worldly, loving people. But God said, well, verse 20, they are without excuse. Why without excuse? Because, verse 19, that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it to them, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. By what? Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. That is the first group. They are without excuse. The second group is in chapter 2, who boast about the law. Oh, the law, chapter 2. Therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are that judges, for wherein you judge another, you condemn yourself, for you that judge do the same things. You always point finger to some other people, all 5. You. But do the same things. Oh, they are not excuse, right? How about the Jews? Okay, those who have the law, verse 13. Not verse 13. Let me read this part. Okay. 17. Behold, you're called a Jew, and rest in the law, and make your boast of God, and know His will, and approve the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law, and are confident you yourself are a guide of the blind, a light of them which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which have the form of knowledge and of the truth in the law. You, therefore, which teach another, teach you not yourself? You that preach a man should not steal, do you steal? You that say a man should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You that abhor idols, do you commit sacrilege? And because of that, verse 23, you that make your boast of the law, through breaking the law, you dishonor God. That's why the conclusion of Paul here, all are under sin. Gentiles and Jews are all under sin. Because we are all lawbreaker. And then he explained, chapter 3. So what is the promise of God there? Forgiveness, justification. And then baptism, chapter 6. And then decision again, yield yourselves as obedient slaves of righteousness. These are the things. But praise the Lord, because God has shown us the best way. And that is, we believe in Christ, and God has taken care of our past sins, right? And because we have the mediator in the heavenly sanctuary, sometimes we sin, but we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. That's the topic last night, I think, right? We have now offering to God, and God has given us grace to follow, to obey. But we are now no longer slaves of sin, but slaves of righteousness, and the end is eternal life. This is the confirmation and vindication of our faith. So when people will tell you, you know what, you're mga sabadista, kayo ay legalista. Ang aking sabi noon, kami tinatawag niyong sabadista, tatawagin ko kayong linggunista. Pagka naman mga Muslim, tawag niyo sa amin sabadista, sa inyo, biyerninista. Hindi, lahat tayo may ta. Pero, sino ang maliligtas? Sangayon sa Biblia. Pagdating ng paghukom, ang aaring ganap yung mga sumusunod sa utos ng Diyos. That is why, Matthew 7, you read Matthew 7, many people will say and come unto me, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Let me read that part before I sit down, or before we sing our closing song here. Matthew 7. Some of you memorized that passage. What is that passage? All right, let me check my Bible here. Yes. Because of these things, what is that verse? Yes, that part. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? In your name have cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. See, it's really sad that they do these wonderful things, but Jesus Christ said, well, I never knew you. So, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, and those people who decided to follow Jesus Christ, God will guide you, and once you be part of God's people, you will become an obedient member of the church. May God bless us all, and let us sing our closing song, When We All Get to Heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout the victory when we all get to heaven. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for giving us grace to obey your will. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for clearing us tonight that our obedience is based on love. And the source of it is our faith. Faith that works. Faith that is alive. Faith that is active. Faith that will bring glory to your name. We know, Heavenly Father, that in these last days, Satan, our enemies, will do his best because he is angry with those people who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And that is why, Heavenly Father, because of this, we fully trust you that you will carry us until the end of times. And someday, we will be in the clouds of heaven to be with you forever and ever. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, may the blessings of the Sabbath and the blessings of God the Father and of Jesus Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit be upon us all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone. And the topic for tomorrow evening is the blessed hope, our blessed hope. Thank you, and God bless us all.